Welcome back to ECE 3300 at the University of Utah. Today in lecture number 8, we're going to be talking about creating inductors and capacitors from simple transmission lines. There are many applications of this technique, so I think you'll find it very useful in practice. We begin with just a simple transmission line. Consider a transmission line which has a length of L and a characteristic impedance Z0. Let's short-circuit this transmission line. That means that the load has a magnitude of 0. The reflection coefficient, and I'm going to make a note that this is the reflection coefficient of the load, is equal to ZL minus Z0 over ZL plus Z0. For the case of a short circuit, this is 0 and this is 0, so the reflection coefficient is minus 1, or it's 1 with a phase of 180 degrees. Let's consider what the voltage looks like on this transmission line. We're considering the voltage as a function of Z. Z equals 0 is here at the load, and Z equals minus L is here at the input. The general expression for this is V0 plus times e to the minus j beta Z plus the reflection coefficient times e to the plus j beta Z. The current, the general equation for the current, is V0 plus divided by Z0 times e to the minus j beta z minus the reflection coefficient times e to the plus j beta z. Now let's consider the special case when we have a short-circuited transmission line. For a short-circuited transmission line, the reflection coefficient is minus 1. Now look at each one of these. This is the sum of an e to the j term and another similar e to the minus j term. This looks a lot like the cosines and sines that we've learned about in math. So consider what the cosine looks like. It is e to the j theta plus e to the minus j theta divided by 2. And the sine of theta is equal to e to the j theta minus e to the minus j theta over 2j. So let's take a look up here at our two cases, the voltage and the current for a short-circuited transmission line, and see if they look like sines or cosines. The stop one has a minus 1, so that's going to be this minus sign right here, and you'll notice that I'm a little backwards. So I have e to the plus j beta z with a minus sign, and e to the minus j beta z with a plus sign out front. So I'm going to end up with a negative sine term. And the theta term here, there's the theta right here, is beta z. Now let's also look out for this. I have a 2 and a j on the bottom that I don't see any place in this equation. So I need to multiply my sine by 2j. The current, on the other hand, this minus and minus cancel out, so that looks a lot like a cosine. In this case, it is equal to 2 times the cosine of beta z. So what does this mean in practice? In practice, it means that my sine right here has a j term in front. That's like being off by 90 degrees. I can see that the voltage and the current have sine and cosine behaviors not as a function of time, but as a function of distance. Now remember in class we talked about the impedance. The impedance, and this is a total impedance as a function of z, is going to be V of z divided by I of z. This is the impedance or the ratio of the voltage and the current any place on the line. Remember again, this does not depend on loss. Loss is not the function here. So I simply am going to take this top term, which is minus 2j times the sine of beta z, and divide it by 2 cosine of beta z. I also have to consider the v0 plus here, so I end up with a z0 out front. My 2's cancel out, and what I end up with is z0 times j tangent of beta z. If I were considering the input to the line, I would put an L here, rather a minus L, and that's how I end up getting rid of this minus sign right here, by putting in a minus L here and a minus L there. A very important consideration is that this impedance is strictly reactive and there is no real part.